A very good morning to all. On behalf of IIP Digital team, I, Dr. Uthra Mohan, welcome you to this webinar on overview on cancer rehabilitation by resource person Dr. Anuradha Daptardar. We are streaming live on IIP India YouTube channel. I request all to subscribe to this channel to get regular notification during our live webinars and to view our previous webinars. Today's webinar is being organized by IIP Palghar District Branch of Maharashtra. Now I request the IIP Palghar team to take over.
Thank you, Dr. Uthra. A very good morning to all the participants, honored guests and respected seniors. I, Dr. Sagar Vasant Mangela, convener of IIP Palghar branch, welcome you all for the webinar, Overview on Cancer Rehabilitation by well-renowned resource person, Dr. Anuradha Daptardar. Before we get started, I would like to introduce Indian Association of Physiotherapists, Central, Maharashtra State and Palghar District team and would like to thank each one of them for their valuable inputs in organizing this webinar. The IIP Central team works under the leadership of President Dr. Sanjeev Jha, Vice President Dr. Suresh Babu Reddy, General Secretary Dr. K. N. Annamalai, Treasurer Dr. Ruchi Vasne, CEP West Zone Dr. Sudeep Kale, Joint Secretary West Zone Dr. Nehal Shah, CEP West Zone Dr. Achal Vashi. IIP Maharashtra State team functions under the supervision of President Dr. Ujwal Yevle, Vice President Dr. Amit Gire, Secretary Dr. Bharti Dave, Treasurer Dr. Sucheta Golar, Joint Secretary Dr. Darshana Trivedi and Dr. Mansi Mehta. EC committee members Dr. Suvarna Ganvi, Dr. Sanjay Rajhans, Dr. Sohan Shelkar, Dr. Suraj Kanse, Dr. Rahul Deshmukh, Dr. Snehal Patel, Dr. Uttara Mohan, Dr. Asmita Moharkar. Coming to the organizing committee, Palghar branch, convener Dr. Sagar Mangela, secretary Dr. Deepali Pawar, treasurer Dr. Jasti Babu, EC members Dr. Bhavesh Balala, Dr. Madhvi Kamath, Dr. Gaurav Birud, Dr. Rashmita Kekre, and Dr. Ashok Bhanushali. Now I would request Dr. Rashmita Kekre to take over. Thank you.
Yes, I welcome all of you. So we all know about the Indian Association of Physiotherapists. I would like to elaborate a few points and the benefits of it. Okay, so Indian Association of Physiotherapists, it is the oldest, the largest and the strongest association. So the benefits that it delivers to us are: it has quick and fast service, no fast track fee. It makes compensation payments, that is indemnity insurance for members. It is international accredited, that is we are known worldwide. We have professional advocacy, that is it involves action, taking action to promote the profession. It has legal support and it has it gives us clinical upgradation. That is always, it has some clinical researches and innovations that it takes, which helps us with our clinical practice. We have career development opportunities with it. And we have camps and awareness activities that takes on, which helps us, which helps in public awareness. We have a lot of newspapers and journals and online YouTube programs, which helps us with the development and our knowledge upgradations. So these are the benefits that we get from the IIP. And so I request all of you to register for the IIP, and we will be putting down a link so or and a contact number where you can access for the IIP registrations. Mm-hmm. And the next thing is, at the end of the session, by Dr. Anuradha Daptardar. There will be a Google link form which will be open for after for a 15 minutes period after the session, through which you can fill it up and obtain the e-certificates. Thank you. Now I forward it to Dr. Justy.
Good morning, everyone. It's an immense pleasure on behalf of IAP Maharashtra State and Palghar District team to be honored to be invite our resource person, Dr. Anuradha Daptardar. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Anuradha Daptardar graduated as a physiotherapist from Sage GS Medical College, Mumbai in 1989. She joined Tata Memorial Hospital in 1991 and has been officer in charge of the physiotherapy department since 2010. She has about 30 years of experience in treating cancer patients. She is an internationally certified lymphedema therapist. In 2014, she received the Significant Achievement Award by Indian Association of Physiotherapists for Indian Association of Physiotherapy for her work in the field of oncology. She pioneered the onco-physiotherapy course in Tata Memorial Hospital in 2016. In 2019, she founded and registered the Society of Onco-Physiotherapists in India, and she is the president of the Society of Onco-Physiotherapists. She has conducted many onco-rehab workshops in Mumbai, Pune, Belgaum, Nashik, Delhi, Mangalore, Bhatinda, and more. She has many national and international publications to her credits. So now I pass over to Dr. Anuradha Daptardar for the webinar.
At the outset, I would like to thank the IAP Maharashtra and the IAP Palghar District for giving me this opportunity to share my experience with all of you. Cancer rehabilitation, like today we are going to talk about the overview. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Overview of cancer rehabilitation. Actually, cancer rehabilitation is a very, very vast topic. But still, I will try to emphasize on what the physiotherapist's role is and what cancer rehabilitation mainly signifies. So can I start sharing my screen?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So basically, like, you know, the first question that comes to our mind is, does physiotherapy differ when you are treating cancer patients? And the answer is yes, it definitely differs. The reason why the difference, because cancer is a disease, like, you know, when the patient is affiliated with this disease, then the patient's general condition is poor. The patient has underlying comorbidities and and we have to tackle a lot of challenges when we are dealing with this patient. The patients are not only having just one simple line of treatment. So they have adjuvant therapy, that is the chemotherapy, radiotherapy, which is going on. Sometimes the tumor comes back again and the patients have to be subjected to these treatments again. So there is a lot of waxing and waning. That is, today the patient you may rehabilitate the patient and achieve the optimum. Then the patient goes in for the therapy and comes back to square one. Like, so you have to again start treating the patient from the baseline. Also, there is a lot of pre-existing infection present because, as I told you, there are a lot of comorbidities and the patient's poor general condition also is responsible for this underlying infection. Debilitation, lack of support and loss of self-esteem. Lack of support because cancer treatment, it really empties your pocket, like, you know. And the patient's, like, you know, monetary part also gets affected. So the patient is demotivated for undergoing the treatment also. Loss of self-esteem because some of the tumors, like tumor of the head and neck, it leaves with lot of disability. So when there is a lot of disability and disfigurement, for the patients to really live their life with it becomes a difficult process. Fear, shock, and malignancy. The name, the word cancer itself causes a lot of fear because it always symbolizes with death. The moment a patient is diagnosed with cancer, the first thought that comes to is, oh my God, I'm going to die. So these are the things that a therapist has to deal with when they are really going to rehabilitate cancer. The basic physiotherapy principles do not change. They remain the same. But there are some modifications and certain red flags that we have to identify when we are dealing with the cancer rehabilitation. What are the goals of treating cancer patients? So for a physiotherapist, the goals is basically respiratory care. As surgery being the prime line of treatment, most of the patients have to undergo surgery at one point of the time or the other for removal of the tumor. So whenever they have to undergo the respiratory care, the post-op chest physiotherapy or the pre-op pulmonary rehabilitation or pre-op chest physiotherapy becomes a prime goal for rehabilitating and recovering and preventing infections for these patients. Mobility, strength, and endurance is very important because as physiotherapists, whenever we have to rehabilitate, these are the principles on which our rehabilitation basically depends on. Functional independence remains the aim. Pain management. Here the pain is not only because of the treatment, but sometimes because of the disease itself. The tumor may be pressing on some important nerves, may be pressing on the muscles, may cause some compression, and that itself is causing the pain. So as long as the tumor is present, the pain is going to persist. So pain management is also very important, and many modalities cannot be used in cancer. So managing pain in cancer is a really a big challenge. Apart from that, there are a lot of psychological issues and psychological aspect also, which we as physiotherapists have to relate to when we are treating cancer patients. Coming to Tata Memorial Hospital, the physiotherapy department offers the following services. So primarily, as I told you, because surgery being the prime line of treatment and respiratory care being utmost, the pulmonary rehabilitation concept is one of the major things that is revolving in the physiotherapy department. Secondly comes the breast, the post-operative breast class and the lymphedema management. Because a lot of numbers, that is like in Tata Memorial Hospital, head and neck cancer has got the huge number. And next comes the breast cancer. So a lot of breast cancer patients get operated. At least approximately 5,000 patients are diagnosed and enrolled in the breast DMG, disease management group. And almost most of the patients are referred to us at one point of the time or the other because they undergo surgery. Coming to the shoulder and neck functions, which is not only following breast cancer, but also following head and neck surgeries. Trismus and facial palsy have lot of cases are seen of trismus and facial palsy, which are one of the major complications when we are dealing with the head and neck cancer patients. Bone tumor rehabilitation. So orthopedic oncology also forms a very big base of onco rehabilitation. Apart from that, the therapy itself, that means the radiotherapy and chemotherapy, which are basically designed to cure the disease or to stop the spread of the disease, have its own lot of side effects. So these side effects also cause a lot of physical as well as psychological problems to these patients. And then after this treatment also, they are referred to the physiotherapy department, and we have to deal with the side effects of these treatments also. Cancer-related fatigue is another major issue, which we will see slowly, because cancer-related fatigue affects almost more than 60% of the cancer patients at one point of the time during their entire treatment. Palliative care. This is again an entity which not many therapists are really coming into contact with, and it is a major issue when it comes to treating oncology patients. That means it is the treatment that is offered at the for a terminally ill patient, or a patient at the end of life. Now, coming to the pulmonary rehabilitation. Pulmonary rehabilitation, as I told you, is offered pre-treatment, during the treatment, that is post-operatively, and also later in life, also during the palliative care. In Tata Memorial Hospital, since we cannot have one-to-one pulmonary rehabilitation, ideally the concept of pulmonary rehabilitation is one-to-one basis, where the patient's cardiopulmonary fitness is evaluated and the programs are offered to these patients. But logistically, it is not possible because most of the patients are outstation patients. You cannot allow ask them to stay back or stay in the hospital or in Mumbai for, you know, going for the pulmonary rehabilitation sessions. So in TMH, what we do is we conduct a group therapy pulmonary rehabilitation session. That means the patients who are going in for surgery, they are evaluated, their cardiopulmonary status is evaluated, and what type of surgery is planned is assessed. Their physical functions are assessed, and they are called for a group therapy session. In the group therapy session, the importance of physiotherapy, respiratory care, why exercises is important to them, training and exercising the big group muscles, and of course, like, you know, all the breathing exercises techniques, coughing techniques, huffing techniques, and spirometry exercises are demonstrated and showed. This is one session. Okay. There was a retrospective study also that was conducted by the department to assess whether this one session has got any significant role to play when it comes to seeing pulmonary rehabilitation. Though the statistically significance was not seen in this one session, but there was a tremendous difference when it came to the hospital stay and the ICU stay. Because those patients who were exposed to this one session at least were aware that what they are supposed to expect post-operatively. So we had better cooperation from them and obviously better adherence to the treatment and better compliance. A further studies, prospective studies should be taken. We have planned to undertake prospective study to really see whether this one session or a group therapy pulmonary rehabilitation session does it have any benefit or not. And very soon we will be putting a proposal for that. Preoperatively, sometimes patients are referred to us from the diagnostic department. When I say diagnostic department, that means, like, you know, patients who have to go in for their barium swallow. Many times to identify the passage, the food passage, and, like, you know, to see for any tumor which is there, or whether the head and neck tumor, any neck tumor is impinging on the food passage, a barium swallow test is done. Many times what happens is because of the compression, patients aspirate this barium after the procedure and they are referred to the physiotherapy department. These patients are given postural drainage and positioning and breathing exercises, and the aspirated barium is expectorated outside. So that is why preoperatively they are referred. Sometimes big tumors, because they have to have, they are constricting on the airways, causing pressure on the airways. So to maintain the airway patency, preoperatively the patients have to undergo tracheostomy, just to maintain airway patency. These patients are also referred to us preoperatively for a pulmonary rehabilitation. And you can see here, you can see a head and neck patient who has undergone a preoperative tracheostomy is using a spirometer exercises for improving the airways so that the patient can go in for a surgery. Post-operatively, the management does not change much. It is the same like in any ICU management. So positioning is very important, tracheal toileting or maintaining the airways, removal of secretions, giving diaphragmatic breathing exercises and thoracic expansion exercises. All this becomes a part of post-operative management in the ICU. The difference that you can see here is most of our patients, like the head and neck cancer, the esophagus cancer, they all cannot be subjected to a head low position. Because head and neck surgeries always have to maintain an upright position as the chances of aspiration post-operatively is very high. So to prevent that, they cannot be even taken on a very supine position. So whatever postural drainage or whatever positioning that we have to give, it will be with this compromised position, and our physiotherapy is also delivered in this compromised position. Certain flaps and certain reconstructive surgeries will not permit any kind of a percussion or vibration on the operated side because of the flaps. So that also compromises our problems when we are dealing with them post-operatively. This is a mechanical percussor that we use in the ICU for the patients. The mechanical percussor has been a big boon to our department, and it facilitates chest physiotherapy with ease. The reason behind this mechanical percussor is it is very even. The percussion is very even. It is distributed very evenly. It has got two percussions. One is which is circular movement, and one is which is perpendicular to the body. This facilitates the secretions to be mobilized to the brain main bronchus, from where it can be expectorated outside. As the head of the mechanical percussor is of different sizes, so we can use these different heads to mobilize the secretions. So small areas can also be percussed well, and you need not worry about, like, you know, because there are a lot of lines and lot of catheters which are there, because cancer surgeries are major surgeries. And accessing these areas with your hand or palm also becomes very difficult. And so you can use this percussor, which is of utmost importance. And it really works well, and it is very effective in our post-operative physiotherapy. Now, coming to the critical care, like any critical care where the patients are on long-term ventilatory support. So it can be either in the form of a non-invasive method, or it can be intubated using an endotracheal tube or a tracheostomy. So maintaining the airways and removal of secretion becomes of importance. So you can see this is the difference where you can, where you are giving a manual percussion and a mechanical percussion. Most of our patients who are on long-term ventilation, they are having a closed suction. So we have a closed suction catheter that is placed, and closed suction is generally, the rate of infection is minimized whenever you're using a closed suction. And only thing disadvantage is the catheters are not very malleable, and they're not very soft. So repeated suctioning can cause trauma and bleeding. But apart from that, like, most of these patients are always placed in a closed suction catheters. Manual bagging is also used, like I'm sure many of you must be knowing and are working in ICUs and are using manual bagging. So manual bagging is also used in our hospital, in our ICU, for patients who are having bad chest congestions or who have got secretions, thick secretions, which are blocking the airways. So you can see that even many times, like, you know, these secretions have to be sent for cultures. And also the role of physiotherapists in the ICU is they have to, since we are delivering the post-operative chest physiotherapy and play a role in removal of secretion, so we help for collecting these secretions also, either by using a T-tube or a secretion mucolytic extractor. Now we see such cases in the ICU also, major chest wall tumors. So when there is a huge tumor which is present on the chest wall, it can involve also the ribs and the thoracic cage and everything. So the defect after removing this tumor is huge. And this defect is either compensated by using a bone cement, it is filled by using a bone cement, or by using a musculocutaneous flap. Now, flap is normally used from the big group of muscles, that is, it can be used from the thigh anterolateral thigh aspect, or it can be used from the latissimus dorsi. So these flaps are used. The problem what happens is whenever such reconstruction occurs, whenever a cement is used to fill the gap, the thoracic mobility gets compromised because cement is a very hard structure and you cannot achieve the expansion and everything. So we are compromised there. Whenever a flap is used, then what happens is the continuity of the thoracic cage is lost and there can be a flail chest. Also, some kind of a splint or support is always required for chest PT or for the chest wall when you are giving the chest physiotherapy. And as I told you, whenever there is a flap, you cannot give any percussion or vibration on the operated side. Vigorous cuffing is not permitted, but huffing always helps in removal of the secretion. Apart from that, you continue with the breathing exercises and the spirometer exercises. And of course, the ambulation, which is very important for maintaining the chest condition. Now, when we come to the esophageal resection, why in these patients we cannot give a postural drainage? So whenever an esophagus tumor is there, the tumor is removed and blocked, like, you know, so few centimeters above the tumor and few centimeters below the tumor, the resection is done. Now, to compensate for this, the stomach being a tubular structure, it is pulled up and it is sutured to the remaining esophagus. You can see this pouch like thing here. Okay. Now, the only risk in this happens what? The patients have three incisions. So they have one neck incision, they have one thoracotomy, and they have one abdominal incision. The neck incision is basically to suture the stomach, which is pulled up to the remaining esophagus. The abdominal incision is mainly to mobilize, and the thoracotomy is for the anastomosis. So whenever these three incisions are there, there are a lot of complications which come with each incisions. Okay. First is because the stomach is sutured to the esophagus, there can be a reflux. All the gastric contents can reflux and cause aspiration. That is the reason all esophageal resections postoperatively have to maintain a 30 degrees of head high position. They cannot even go supine. Even if they have to lie supine, they have to use two pillows to maintain that head high position. So you cannot give a postural drainage, you cannot give a head low position, and you can't even give a supine position. So automatically your physiotherapy maneuvers that are to be delivered gets compromised. So you give a modified postural drainage. So you maintain the head high position, but you can give the lateral positions to drain the secretions. Second thing, the cord palsy. Because of the neck incision, many times the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which lays in that area, gets tampered or stretched. This results in our vocal cords getting paralyzed. So what happens whenever the vocal cords gets paralyzed, there is a very poor cough reflex. And the poor cough reflex results in secretions that are accumulated. Clearing of the secretions becomes a major problem. So an external tracheal stimulation using a finger or an intratracheal injection of soda bicarb by the anesthetist is recommended to clear out the secretion. Huffing helps the patients a lot rather than coughing, because coughing causes a lot of pain. Most of these patients are given epidural analgesia, so the pain factor is reduced and taken care of. So rest, as I told you, for rest of the physiotherapy manuals of expansion, spirometry exercises, and your diaphragmatic breathing, and your segmental breathing, and percussion, everything is the same as in other physiotherapy. Mobilization of cancer patients post-surgery is very important, because these patients are already debilitated prior to surgery itself. So when they are post-operatively for a long time in the ICU, it causes more debilitation. And debilitation and immobilization has got its own side effects. That is why early mobilization is recommended. In TMH, we follow the ERAS protocol, that is early recovery after surgery. So our concentration is mainly to ambulate the patient immediately if it is feasible. If it is not feasible, then at least to mobilize the patient on a chair and to at least make the patient stand as per the vitals. For monitoring the vitals and other factors, early mobilization is encouraged. So that was the overview of respiratory care for the patients in TMH. Now we move on to the rehabilitation in breast cancer. So whenever the patient is diagnosed with breast cancer, either the patient is offered a breast conservation therapy or a total removal, that is a mastectomy. Young patients, if they don't want to go for a mastectomy, are even offered a breast reconstruction surgery. BCT is a breast conservation where the lump is removed and a primary closure is done. So these patients don't have much problem, but any breast surgery always involves removal of the lymph nodes. The lymph nodes are either removed for sampling or entire lymph nodes is removed from the axillary area. Cancer surgeries basically always goes with removal of lymph nodes. The only reason is they can stop the spread and also to understand how much, whether there is a nodal spread or not present, and whether these patients do require any kind of an adjuvant therapy post-operatively. So what are the things that we have to look at immediately post-operatively? So post-operatively acute care, there is something called as a post-operative breast class. The reason we conduct this class is because in TMH, the patients go home the very next day. So when they go home the very next day, it is very important that these patients are going home with the drain itself. And they are called back only after 2 weeks for the suture removal, drain removal. Patients have to be given certain instructions post-operatively. Instructions regarding the exercises, instructions regarding the drain care, how to measure and monitor the drain, instructions regarding how to take care of their skin, their arm, what are the do's and don'ts, what are the risk reduction they have to do to avoid a major comorbidity called lymphedema. So all these things are covered under one comprehensive session. Since the patients are going home the next day, all the patients are collected post-operatively in the physiotherapy department. A volunteer is a part of this program, and the volunteers are majorly survivors who have undergone this cycle, so they can relate better with these patients. Volunteers do the counseling part. The therapists guide the patient with the exercises and also give all the other instructions. So this session is conducted for at least an hour to 1.5 hour. And all the requirements, like, you know, what are the patients have to take care following their surgery, is conveyed to them in one single session. So as I told you, this is the breast class where the patients are gathered together. You can see the therapist counseling the patient and showing them the different exercises. And all the important aspects like the drain care, the wound care, skin care, diet, do's and don'ts, exercises, self-breast examination, requirement of prosthesis post-mastectomy, and a risk, how to reduce the risk for lymphedema, are conveyed to the patient in one session. What are the instructions that is normally given to these patients? So instructions given are, make sure that all injections are given and blood tests are drawn in the unaffected arm. The reason behind this, as I told you, since the lymph nodes are removed, the chance of the patients having infection of that arm, infection of the lymphatics, and something leading to lymphedema is high. The risk is very high. So you don't have to cause any injury or trauma to that arm. That is the reason that all injections, punctures, blood collections, blood tests, even a simple diabetic sugar test is also avoided from the affected arm. The same can be done or performed in the unaffected side. Suppose if there is a bilateral involvement, then the patients can undergo all these procedures using the foot veins. The veins and vessels from the foot can be used for collecting and drawing injections. The patients are advised not to wear any tight clothing or jewelry because they should not impede the lymphatic flow. They are advised not to carry heavy packages or handbags on the affected arm. They are asked to do all these from the unaffected side. And if at all they have to lift something heavy, they have to use both their arms for distributing the weight. Not to use an electric shaver when shaving underarms. They are not supposed to wax the underarms or wax the arm because it can pull the skin, it can damage the lymphatics, which are very superficial, and it can cause damage and lead to lymphedema. They are supposed to take care while cutting the fingernails. They have to avoid cutting cuticles. And if at all any cuts occur, then it has to be washed and thoroughly cleaned with soap and water. And then an antibacterial or antiseptic ointment and a sterile dressing is used to prevent any infection. Vigorous repetitive movements against resistance, such as scrubbing, pulling, pushing, is avoided using the affected arm. Gloves are advised while doing gardening. Thimble is used while sewing. And also the arm is asked to be kept elevated whenever possible. And exercises is very, very important to improve the drainage. So all these instructions are given to the patient post-operatively, and these instructions have to be observed or followed lifetime. These are not just post-op instructions, these are lifetime instructions, because lymphedema need not occur immediately post-op. It can occur even 3 months, 6 months, 2 years, 6 years post-surgery also. So it is a lifetime instructions. Exercises are basically mainly concentrated on the breathing exercises. Breathing exercises is important because, as I told you, you have to have good lymphatic drainage. Diaphragmatic breathing is encouraged because most of the lymphatics drain in the thoracic duct, and the thoracic duct is situated at the abdominal level. Hence, you have to do diaphragmatic breathing exercises to open up these ducts. Shoulder girdle exercises are important for relaxation. Main are the mobility exercises and the pumping exercises. The mobility exercises is important because full range of movement or full arm movement is required to drain the lymphatics. Pumping exercises are done repetitively after every 2 to 3 hours to facilitate arm elevation and also to pump and drain the lymphatics. This is all preventive exercises to prevent lymphedema. Coming to the breast reconstructive surgeries, there can be reconstruction using a breast silicone reconstruction can be done, or you can use flaps for reconstruction. The common flaps that are used are the LD flap, latissimus dorsi flap, and the rectus abdominals, or a DIEP, that is deep inferior epigastric flap. So these are normally used. So breast is removed and the defect is covered by using a healthy tissue. A tissue mound is used. This the patient's own tissue is used to create a mound. So a breast mound is achieved. Only thing is a nipple. These patients will not have a nipple. So either an artificial nipple can be stitched to that mound, or a dark tattooing can be done to replicate a nipple. What is the care that is to be taken when these patients are undergoing the reconstructive surgery? the exercises and the protocols, the mobility and all the other instructions remain the same, but the shoulder movements can get delayed as per the plastic surgeon's instruction to at least 3 to 5 days. The reason behind is any reconstructive surgery, there can be some microvascular surgery involved, and to heal that area, there is some precaution to be taken to see that it is anastomosis are maintained rightly. So the delay is there in the shoulder movements. Scar massage is always recommended to these patients because there is a big flap, there is a huge scar, the scar of the donor area also, and the operated area also. So you have to encourage a scar massage and see that there is no keloids or no adherence that is present, because this can even restrict your shoulder functions. Trunk flexion is normally recommended whenever a TRAM, that is a rectus abdominis flap or a deep inferior epigastric flap, is used. The reason is to maintain the anastomotic line for some few days. For the first initial 5 days, the patient is asked to walk with a little bit of trunk flexion to avoid stretch to the anastomotic site. Gradually, after the 5th day, slowly the patient is asked to go erect slowly and gradually can become fully erect. Since abdominal muscles are used, the reason for an abdominal strengthening exercises is mandatory for these patients postoperatively. But that is only initiated 3 months post-surgery. After the first month, after the sutures are removed, you can ask the patient to go for static exercises, isometric exercises, and gradually strengthening exercises can be initiated by 3 months post-operative. There is something called an axillary web syndrome, which is commonly seen in patients post-operatively. Okay. The incidence, as you see, is 20% after just a lymph node biopsy, and it is about 44 to 72% after an axillary node dissection. The reason behind this is what happens is whenever the axillary nodes are removed, okay, the lymphatics, there is an injury to the lymphatics, and many times stasis and hypercoagulability occurs, because of which the lymphatic channels, they pop up like a cord-like structure. So cord-like structure you can see, which is felt under your fingers when you're palpating. And also many times it can be seen as a red streak, cord-like thing, which is running from the axilla, crossing the elbow, and can go even up to the base of the thumb. How do you identify this? Patients always come to you with the pain in the arm and they complain that they are not able to lift their arm fully. The moment you go to do a shoulder flexion, complete flexion for these patients, they can only do the flexion by flexing their elbow. The moment you stretch and extend their elbow, they have excruciating pain, and which prevents them from doing the full movement. Immediately palpate and see, you can see the cord-like structure. Normally, it develops 3 weeks to 3 months post-surgery. These patients can also have a risk of lymphedema, because if they don't have full range of motion, then draining of lymphatics become a problem. And many times, because it is a lymphovenous injury, the flow of the lymphatics is also compromised, and the patients have a higher incidence and risk of developing lymphedema. So identifying this axillary web syndrome is very important, and giving treatment for it is very important. So you can see here, this is the cord-like structure that comes from the axilla and it runs in the arm, or you can see that this is the welt that you can see running down the lymphatic channels. You can feel the cord has to be broken. So initially, what is advised is you can give moist heat to this area to soften it, and deep friction massage is important. So you have to stretch longitudinal and transverse by the therapist. So you teach the massage to the patient also, to the relative, and the therapist gives longitudinal transverse massage over the cord and tries to break the cord. also you have to stretch. Stretching is very important. You can even teach self-stretching program to the patient. They are laser therapy, kinesio taping. There are many studies which show that laser and kinesio tape have also helped in treating axillary web syndrome. Though the sample sizes in these studies are very less, but still to some extent they have shown some effect. But I think larger studies are required to see whether this definitely can be introduced as the main line of treatment for axillary web syndrome. But the gold standard is stretching exercises and friction massage. Teaching the patient self-pressed examination is important. Why? It is basically an instrument or a tool that the patient has with her to identify any kind of a recurrence or to identify any kind of a tumor on the other unaffected breast. Self-breast examination is taught to this patient. It has to be performed only once in a month. For menstruating women, ideally the best time to do this examination is from the fifth day of their menstrual cycle to 10 days. That is the best period because during the menstrual cycle, sometimes the breasts are very tender and it is very difficult for them to really do the palpation. So from say 5th to 10th day is the best time for doing self-breast examination in menstruating women. In women whose menstrual cycle has stopped because of the chemotherapy or who have attained menopause, then they have to identify one date in the month. And every month on the same date, they perform this self-breast examination. To perform this, first the woman has to stand, has to lie down, and the breast which has to be examined, she has to extend her arm overhead. So the breast side which has to be treated, that side the arm is kept elevated, and using the other arm, the tip, not the tips of the fingers, but the flat finger surfaces, it is used to examine. So you place the fingers and you gently press, and you are doing circular movement or a vertical, horizontal movement. So you cover the entire area of the breast. So you cover one area, then you move, then you cover the other area, you move. So either you go in a round from outer end to the interior, or you can move horizontally up and down from the top to the bottom. Also, you feel the axilla, you check for the nodes, and if anything suspicious you feel, then you have to get it clinically examined by a doctor to identify if everything is okay or not. So clinical breast self-breast examination is important for the patients to identify. And it is the best tool even for clinicians, because even mammography is not recommended. It is only recommended for women after the age of 50. And it is advocated or advised only once in a year. Whereas this is a good tool which can be performed every month, and it can guide from any recurrence or any disease that is occurring. Post mastectomy, body image becomes a problem. So cosmetically also for a woman, losing a breast is very demoralizing. Full self-esteem is lost, and it is psychologically very affected because you relate the breast to a feminism. So you feel the woman doesn't feel wanted. She feels that now she is not complete. So this can be compensated. You know, there is a lot of body balance. The balance is lost because one part is like now the breast is lost. So there is a discrepancy. Lot of postural issues also arise because of this. So to compensate it, we can use external breast prostheses. Now, breast prostheses are used post-mastectomy to compensate for the lost breast. So prostheses are available in two types. One is cotton, which are filled with beads or sand to give the weight, and the other is a silicone. The cotton prostheses or the silicone prostheses are fitted into a mastectomy bra. The mastectomy brazier has got pockets on both the sides. So whichever side is affected, the prosthesis can be just slid into that pocket and the patient can put on the bra. The cotton prosthesis do not have longer life because they can get damaged. They cannot be washed and the cloth get disrupted, sutures come away. So then they have to be replaced. But also they are very economical. So the issue of replacement doesn't really cost you much. Silicone prosthesis look like breast itself, feels like breast. They have got a proper weight. So weight discrepancy is also best matched with the silicone prosthesis. They have got longer life, say about 2 to 3 years. They can be washed and they are the best thing. So you can, whichever patients, we don't really advocate that you go in for this. We offer them both the prostheses. So as per their economical status and their requirement, they can decide which prostheses they really want to go to. Now coming to the morbidity of lymphedema, one of the major morbidity following breast cancer treatment is lymphedema. Lymphedema can occur in the lower limb as well as upper limb. So following any gynecological surgery, you can have lymphedema when the pelvic nodes and all are resected or when the groin nodes are resected, the patient can develop lower leg lymphedema. So it is swelling of an arm or leg or other part of the body due to an abnormal collection of the fluid called lymph in the body tissues. Among breast cancer patients, the incidence is somewhere as less as 6% to as large as 30%. There are different stages of lymphedema. So they come at 0, 1, 2, and 3 stage. 0 is when you call it as a subclinical stage. Subclinical stage, that means the patient feels that her hand is getting swollen or there is a fluid filling in her arm. But clinically, there is no difference between the girth, there is no difference between the volume, and visibly there is no edema present. But there is, that means there is some damage to the lymphatics and the transport is still not much affected. So in a subclinical stage, only exercises is sufficient. So pumping exercises, elevation helps in treating this lymphedema. Stage one, when there can be a minimal edema present, there can be a pitting or non-pitting. The edema is basically very soft and elevation, many times exercises and elevation helps to reduce the edema. Stage two, when it comes, that is the irreversible stage where actual intervention or treatment of lymphedema is advocated or suggested. The reason behind is here that tissues may be more, there can be pitting present, there can be some tissue changes present. Now tissues are becoming a little hard. There is a brawny kind of a feel and sometimes some fibrosis is also seen. So only elevation and exercises does not reduce this edema. Something more like in compression or bandaging or intermittent pneumatic compression therapy, all these are suggested. So this is the stage when actual treatment is required, where you can, therapist can intervene and reduce the edema. Stage three is now a very severe edema where the tissues are very fibrotic, swelling can be tremendous, and sometimes the swelling is oozing from the skin, which is we call as weeping edema. Fluid is leaking out. There can be skin disruption. There can be infection, all these things. So this is a very severe stage. And this is more seen in the lower extremity than in the upper extremity. How do you measure lymphedema? The easiest measurement that normally is practiced everywhere is the circumferential measurement. So measurements are taken at various points. So ideally at 4 centimeters difference, points are marked. The measurement, circumferential measurements with tape is taken on the affected side and it is compared to the normal side. So any difference of less than 2 or equal to 2 centimeters is coming under the category of mild lymphedema. greater than 2 and less than 5 is coming as moderate, and anything greater than 5 is as severe lymphedema. The another gold standard method is the water displacement method. That is a volumeter. We have a volumeter which is available in the department, and it is a gold standard because the water gets displaced. So you ask the patient to immerse the affected as well as the non-affected arm inside the volumeter. The water that is coming, flowing out is collected in a measuring container, and whatever amount of water is displaced will give you the volume. Okay, so the difference in the volume will tell you the volume of edema that is seen. So anything, if the difference is less than 20%, it is graded as mild. If it is between 20 to 40% of displacement, it is graded as moderate. And anything more than 40% is graded at severe. So these are the different ways of measuring lymphedema. This is the general thing. Apart from that, you have bioimpedance spectroscopy machine, which is an expensive machine, but it can identify lymphedema because it gives you the ratio of the intracellular and the extracellular fluid. So this ratio is a predictor. So it can identify lymphedema 9 months before the onset. So it can be used for identifying the risk and also predicting the lymphedema. How do you manage if lymphedema sets in? You manage it by self-care skills because it is a long-term treatment. So initially the therapist is, the patients are called to the department and the treatment is offered to them on day-to-day basis, for daily basis for a period of about 2 weeks. Gradually a weaning is done where the patients are taught all these techniques and they are supposed to continue the same at their home. Because lymphedema, once it occurs, it does not go away. So you never call it as treatment, you call it as management because you are only managing and controlling the edema. So elevation exercises, there is something called as a manual lymphatic drainage, which is nothing but mobilizing gently the lymph fluid towards the patent lymph nodes. So it is just simple maneuver or movement of the skin. It is a technique that has to be mastered. Tata Memorial Hospital Physiotherapy Department conducts this course once every year. It is normally conducted in the month of August or September, where hands-on training of manual lymphatic drainage and multi-layered bandaging are given to the therapist. An exam is conducted at the end of the training and a certificate of practice is issued to these therapists so that they can practice lymphedema. Many hospitals in Mumbai and out of Mumbai in from India, therapists have registered, and more than 100 by conducting workshops since last so many years. So far, at least more than 100 therapists have been trained and given this, taught these techniques. And we have a network of lymphedema therapists. So a WhatsApp group of lymphedema therapists is created. So from different cities and different areas, whenever patients come to us, we can recommend these therapists. The patients can visit them and get the treatment that is offered at TMH. Then compression sleeves, wearing compression garment is mandatory for these patients because whatever reduction is occurred has to be maintained. So that is the reason these patients have to be fitted with a compression garment. And of course, there is something called a mechanical drainage. Like where you are having a manual, there is a machine which is mimicking your manual lymphatic drainage, and it is called as an intermittent pneumatic compression. So these are the different techniques. So you can see this is a manual lymphatic drainage, and these are the different multi-layered bandaging. So you have a stockinette first, then you have the finger bandaging, then you have a foam leather, and you have the short stretch bandages. Later on, you have called something called as a pneumatic compression. So this is a sleeve, it mimics. So these are different chambers, 12 chambered sleeve is there. So there is a pressure that is causing a compression of one compartment, and gradually the pressure moves on to the next. So there is a sequential pressure that is sent from the distal to the proximal, and it is mimicking the lymphatic drainage. post this treatment, always a bandaging is done or a compression garment is fitted to maintain the reduction stage of the lymphedema. Exercises, as I already told you, breathing exercises, why it is important. Flexibility arm stretches is important as it increases the lymphatic flow. And along with that, gradual strengthening exercises are initiated because the lymphedema arm has to be strong. When there is a strength present, then it can prevent further injuries to that arm. So for that, you have to build up the strength of the arm. Swimming is advised for these patients and pumping exercises. Patient can also use weights, can go to the gym to do progressive strengthening exercises. But all these exercises are mandatory and they have to do these exercises by putting on the compression garment. Now we come to the next major thing, that is the head and neck surgeries. Following the head and neck surgery, there is lot of dysfunction and disability. So the focus is that, like, you know, since the head and neck surgery, your shoulder functions are the one that is affected. The neck functions are the one that is affected. Your mouth opening gets affected. Your speech and swallowing gets affected. Okay. And there is also lot of disability, so disfigurement. So even your cosmetic-wise also, there is a lot of psychological impact. The major surgeries are glossectomy, surgeries of the tongue, the maxilla, mandible, larynx, parotid gland. All the surgeries are majorly followed by neck dissections. As I told you, lymphatic lymph node dissection is a part of any cancer surgery. So for the head and neck, the neck nodes are basically dissected. For a breast, the axillary lymph nodes are dissected. And for surgery of the pelvis or of the abdomen or anything, it is the pelvic nodes, abdominal nodes, or the groin nodes that are taken care of. How does the rehabilitation focus on following head and neck? Okay, so this is, you assume it to be like a triangle. So the basal area is the surgeries which do not involve major surgeries. Then as it goes up, you can see your rehabilitation becomes more concentric and it becomes more comprehensive and it has to be more focused. So you start with primary closure. Primary closures are where the tumor is present in any part of your buccal mucosa, the neck or anywhere. It is removed and it is closed. Okay, does not involve any kind. There is not much defect. And so there is not much reconstructive surgery or defect covering surgery to be issued. So primary closures are very easy to deal with. Your neck and shoulder exercises can be started immediately, post-operatively. Like for example, your neck dissections or your modified neck dissections. Surgery which involves your modified neck dissection, radical neck dissections, functional neck dissection, all these surgeries, immediately the neck and shoulder exercises can be initiated. Chest therapy is important because post-operatively, since these patients are subject to anesthesia, you have to, and since they may be having some underlying comorbidity present, you have to focus on their respiratory care post-operatively. Now comes the reconstructive surgeries, where you can use only skin grafts, where regional flaps are used or distant flaps are used. Regional flaps are used means that means you are using a pectoralis major muscle or you are using a deltoid flap or a forehead flap, which is close to that area and it is easily, can be easily accessed to cover the defect. Distant flaps are, that means you are taking the fibula or you are taking the radial artery foramen flap for the lateral anterolateral aspect of the thigh. So these are the distal flap. So as the flaps are there, once the reconstructive surgery comes, then there is a delay in your mobilization, delay in your ambulation. But respiratory care is of utmost importance because most of the time these patients have tracheostomy or the flaps are present in such a way, tracheal toileting or coughing up secretions becomes very difficult. Shoulder and neck dysfunctions, like, you know, this is where you can see modified neck dissection. This is a radical neck dissection and a functional neck dissection. These, whenever the radical neck dissection, that means it is removal of structures like the spinal accessory nerve, sternocleidomastoid, submandibular gland. So what happens is you can see the structures that are removed here. You can see how much of radical surgery is being done. Then these patients have a lot of problem, shoulder functions issue, and shoulder functions you do not achieve completely also. Okay, reason behind is there is a lot of stretch to these muscles. So there is a drooping shoulder present. So you have to concentrate on other shoulders, scapular shoulder muscles to maintain some kind of function at the shoulder. You are getting full movement, ROM is also very difficult. Nowadays, these surgeries are not done. Only the modified neck dissection or the functional neck dissection is done, where the patients do not have much problem since all the major structures are present and you can easily achieve full range of motion of the shoulder as well as neck post-operatively. Only thing is the exercises have to be initiated immediately. That is from the first post-operative itself. So you have the assisted exercises using a pulley. Okay, you have to concentrate on the shoulder girdle exercises, stretching exercises. You can see abduction, bilateral abduction becomes a problem whenever these patients have bilateral neck dissections. And self-assisted exercises, you can see the flap here. This is a PMMC or a pectoralis major flap that is taken. So you can see that if this is exercises are not initiated in it immediately, then by the time the sutures are removed, you can expect some kind of stiffness or restricted movement at the shoulder. When reconstruction is involved, that means when there is a flap, when a pedicle flap is taken. So when a pedicle flap is taken, then you're restricting the range of motion only up to 90 degrees, because anything beyond that will cause stretch on this anastomosis. So you go to the shoulder flexion up to 90 degrees, abduction up to 90 degrees. You wait for the dissection of this flap before you initiate overhead movements as well as the neck movements. The neck is slowly maintained on that side. So it is turned a little bit to that side of the flap side and a little bit laterally flexed to avoid any stretch on this pedicle. So that is why after the pedicle is dissected, which normally happens after 3 weeks, you can initiate with the neck exercises and the overhead shoulder exercises. When a flap is not there, pedicle flap is not there, and it is only a myocutaneous flap, then you can easily start with a range of motion exercises immediately post-operative. What are the things you have to normally watch up, red flags? One is you have to watch out for the skin necrosis. So darkening, if any darkening of the skin is noticed, or if there is any oozing, or if there is any bleeding, you have to watch out for, and you have to report it to the doctor. A tracheostomy suctioning, when you're performing, it has to be very gentle. The reason behind is, since there is a flap involved around that area, the neck area, and the carotid artery is very close by, okay? If any necrosis of the flap occurs, the carotid artery gets ruptured. Then when you do any vigorous suctioning, the chance of a carotid artery rupture is immense, okay? So it has occurred also. So you have to be very careful when you are treating these flap cases. So you advocate gentle tracheostomy suctioning, and slowly the tracheostomy is closed. Like, you know, you go for a partial closure and then you go for a complete closure, and you initiate the patient to start using their normal pathways of breathing and coughing, and you encourage them to expectorate the secretions through their mouth rather than the tracheostomy. Now, when the free flaps are involved, that is when you're using a fibular graft, an anterolateral thigh flap, or a radial artery forearm flap, okay? So you can see that post-operatively, maintaining of the neck position becomes very important when you're treating these patients in the ICU. So since the neck has to be maintained, even you cannot turn these patients, okay? And you wait till that time when the patients can maintain the neck in a neutral position. That time only is the time when you can go for the sideline turning of these patients. These patients, whenever positioning has to be given, only half turn is achieved with neck being in the neutral position. Even when they are brought to the wards also, for some period of time, they are asked to always keep their neck in an erect straight position only and not go for any turning sides. This is to maintain the flap. So whenever a fibular graft is used, okay, you have to concentrate on the donor site also. So it is not only rehabilitating of the operated site, but disease site, but also you have to rehabilitate it and take care of the donor site. You can see an anterolateral thigh flap whenever it is given, the patient are given a long knee brace. So you can imagine these patients are kept for at least 2 to 3 weeks in this long knee brace. So their knee functions and knee movements also get restricted. So gradually you have to start with their knee movement also. And ambulation is always using some kind of a support. So they are not allowed to immediately weight bear and ambulate. So they go for a partial weight bearing. And gradually after the first wound check is done, when the plastic surgeries give you the green signal, then you go on to the full weight bearing. The fibular graft patients are normally put in a posterior slab. So till the slab is removed, the patients are ambulated only using a walker and a partial weight bearing. So in short, it is the donor site area also have to be taken care of when you are rehabilitating these patients. So flap care, respiratory care, donor site area care also to be taken, donor site exercises, shoulder exercises because the primary disease is in the head and neck region, ambulation using a aid or a support. Tumors of the larynx and rehabilitating a laryngectomy is a very challenging thing because whenever the patient's larynx is removed, either it is partial removal or total, communication is the one major issue. Communication gets affected. So these patients lose their speech. There are different ways of speeches that these patients can perform, which I will tell slowly. We have got excellent speech therapy department and our speech therapist is doing tremendous role to play whenever he's rehabilitating head and neck cancer patients. Because even surgeries which involve the tongue, these patients, the speech gets affected. If there is a partial removal, also the speech gets affected. Total glossectomy where the entire tongue is removed, also the speech gets affected. So training these patients using the other mouth muscles is very important and it is a great challenge for the speech therapist that is present. The laryngectomy patients, as you can see, have always got an open stoma and this is lifetime. So the care is taken that this stoma is always kept covered so that dust particles and other foreign things cannot go in and cause any infection. So post-operatively, the patients are advised to always wear a bib, which can be just a cloth bib or something like a vest. They can use it, which looks nice cosmetically also. And it looks like a t-shirt rather than a bib-like. Careful suctioning, because now this is an open stoma. So that means you're directly entering the trachea, okay? So whenever you have to suction this patient post-operatively, it is very important. So you do again a gentle suctioning because as we told you, there is always neck dissections and the carotid artery rupture incidence is also there. So you go for a gentle suctioning post-operatively. Now these patients, there are some bathing precautions they have to take. Since they have an open stoma, for them, if the water enters the stoma, then there can be a cough syncope because they can immediately start coughing. and it can cause a lot of problem to their suture lines and also to their this. So whenever they are asked to bathe, they are supposed to hold their neck and they are supposed to flex their neck and then they are supposed to bathe, especially when they are washing their hair and everything. These patients, another one major thing is some of them are fitted with this kind of a voice prosthesis inside. Okay. This voice prosthesis is basically a puncture, tracheoesophageal prosthesis, it is called a TEP. This facilitates the speech. So every time the patient has to speak, the patient closes the stoma with a thumb. So this stoma is closed with his thumb and air is trapped inside. And the movement of the airways, the column, it causes phonation. And the patient uses this phonations to speak, like it uses this sounds to phonate and to speak. So it is a tremendous work of the speech therapist and we really appreciate their efforts in taking care of the speech and the swallowing difficulties these patients have. Of course, since they have bilateral neck dissections present, achieving full shoulder range of motion, especially full abduction and flexion and neck movements is also important from a physiotherapy point of view. So you can see communication is basing an esophageal speech. That means that they swallow air inside, trap the air and try to speak. It is very difficult to learn. More energy is required and only a couple of words can be spoken at one time. TEP, the voice prosthesis, is much better. There can be valve malfunction, which leads to aspiration. And the sound, the speech is also very much natural. Last is the electronic larynx, which is used for speech. And it is placed in the neck and it is vibrated. And you can have the vibrations can cause the sounds and which helps to phonate and speak. Major issue for a physiotherapist is trismus. Now the trismus can be either preoperatively. Many times it is caused by a precancerous condition called a submucous fibrosis. This is very common in patients who are eating this gutka or who chew betel nut and everything. So you can see they have this leukoplakic type of things, the white bands that you can see here, which develops in their buccal mucosa. Now this restricts the mouth opening. Also it their tongue protrusion is decreased and it causes a lot of burning sensation in the mouth. So once the pathology is done and it is free of any disease, that means it is a precancerous condition and cancer cells are not present still, you can give ultrasound to these patients. So ultrasound is given externally over the cheek muscle to break down the bands and followed by a jaw stretcher key for stretching the tensile bands. So you have to break these bands. So first you make them soft and then you use a jaw stretcher key to stretch these and achieve the mouth opening. So you can see this is a measurement which is seen pre and post treatment. So mouth opening is measured, the inter-incisor space is measured and that distance is checked and compared to see the improvement. So these are the different jaw stretcher keys that you've seen in the market, okay? And these are the silicone mouth blocks, okay? So whenever there is a mouth opening that is achieved, it has to be maintained for some period of time. So whatever mouth opening is achieved with the jaw stretcher key, you put in this mouth blocks for sustained stretch. So they are like wedges you can see. So as per the improvement, the wedge can be increased. So one point, trismus is seen even after radiation. So radiotherapy also causes a lot of trismus. Anyway, the management remains the same for any kind of trismus. Only ultrasound is not recommended. It is only recommended in precancerous condition, that is the submucous fibrosis. But if the trismus is because of postoperative tightness of the structures or because of radiation, then you only recommend the jaw stretcher key at the silicone mouth block and you don't give any ultrasound. because as we have learned in our electrotherapy and everything, though it is, there is no definite studies that have been conducted to say that this can cause any tumor metastasis or spread of tumor, it is still not recommended because it causes increased blood supply and it can break down the tissues and everything. So following our principles of our electrotherapy, we don't normally recommend any modalities for cancer. Ethically, there are no studies, like, you know, ethically, we are not permitted to conduct any studies to see whether it can be given or not, because the risk of spread is always there. So hence, we don't normally recommend, and we recommend only the manual therapy for treating cancer patients. Then facial palsy, when parotid tumors are involved, like, you know, you have this major issue of the facial palsy because the facial nerve runs close by it. So if the nerve is only involved, that is, there is no nerve is not sacrificed, it is intact, but there is some traction injury or some edema, because of the edema it is pressed, then you can go with the regular facial palsy management. That means you can initiate stimulation after 3 weeks. You start with the facial exercises and the massage postoperatively. But if the facial nerve is sacrificed or it is involved in the tumor and has to be resected, then obviously you have to give us facial splint compulsorily to prevent any deviation, facial deviation. And a tarsography is normally done, that is partial closure of the eyelid surgically is done, because these patients cannot close their eyes due to the sacrifice of the nerve. And to take care of the eye and prevent eye infection, a partial closure of the eyelid is performed. Maxillofacial prosthesis role is very important whenever you are dealing with the head and neck patients. This is important because, as I told you, the structural changes are augmented whenever they have to remove the tumor. Like, for example, a mandible can be a hemimandible, a partial mandible can be removed, but a total mandible is removed. So whenever a partial is removed, you know that the jaw does not have any continuity. Okay, so something has been maintained for approximation, because the jaw can deviate to one side. How do you hold it in place? There is something called a mandibular guiding prosthesis. This is given by the maxillofacial department. And after that, the patients are sent to us, which is for us to do the jaw exercises and also the approximation exercises to help them do their food so that they can chew and eat the food. Second thing, there can be some maxillofacial prosthesis, because whenever maxilla is removed, then there is an opening now. So there can be aspiration, that is from the nose to your mouth and all. So then that has to be blocked. So there are some operators or prosthesis given for that. Chin support and facial splint is discussed already. Chin support is basically given because of many times because of flaps within the oral cavity. These flaps are big. The closure of the mouth becomes difficult. So whenever the patient's mouth doesn't close properly, there is drooling of the saliva present. This can enter the tracheostomy or enter can drool on the wound, on the stitches, on the surgery site, and it can cause infection. So to prevent that drooling, a chin strap is given, or you can also advocate a elastocrepe bandage tied over the around the head for closing the mouth. Now let's move on to the major topic of interest amongst all physiotherapists, that is the orthopedic oncology, bone and soft tissue tumors. Management of the soft tissue sarcoma postoperatively is very easy. It is because, like, none of the bones are involved. So your weight bearing and your ambulation, your mobility doesn't really get affected. Yes, if the tumors are very close to the joint, then sometimes the joints have to be maintained, giving some kind of a splint so that you prevent any type of a contracture. The major soft tissue sarcomas, normally you can see in the thigh area, in the buttock area. Okay, these are the areas which are normally involved. So anytime after surgery, it is very easy. The joint proximal and distal to the disease is mobilized, and you can immediately ambulate the patient. Only the wound check has to be done. So once the surgeon examines the wound and advises ambulation, you can immediately start with full weight-bearing ambulation for the patient. And you have to strengthen the proximal and the distal joint muscles. Now coming to the limb salvage surgery. Many times limb salvage is the current trend. Initially, what used to happen whenever any bone tumor is there, amputation was the prime line of treatment, sacrificing the limb. Nowadays, with technology, with modern medicine and everything, and with different kind of prosthesis available, limb salvage has become the major line of treatment in bone tumors. So the salvage can be either in the form of using grafts, the bone graft, self autograft or allograft, that is from the bone, can be used to take care of the defect, or any kind of a prosthesis is used. So whenever there is an upper limb here, I'm just giving an example, like you can see, this is a graft or a plate. This is a plate that is used, okay, whenever there is a tumor of the upper end of humerus. This is a prosthesis that you can see here, endoprosthesis. So there are different ways in which you can take care. Only thing is your management doesn't change, whether it is a graft or whether it is a this. See, whenever an attachment is given to cover the defect, the muscle attachment is lost. Okay, muscles are attached to the areas that are provided in the prosthesis, but the leverage is always, the mechanical leverage is lost, and you cannot achieve the range of motion at that point. So suppose if an upper end of humerus is involved, then your shoulder functions are lost, but you can have excellent elbow and hand functions. So as therapist, our concentration is mainly to get full elbow and hand functions, so that patients can be physically functional. They cannot do overhead activities. They may not be getting any function at the shoulder. Only pendular movements are available, but still their independence and their functional ability is not lost. They can still do all their ADL activities well. Scapula. Scapula can be either partial scapulectomy or total scapulectomy. So whenever the scapula is removed, you know, our shoulder girdle functions get compromised. Okay, so the same here, we may not get the shoulder functions, but good elbow and hand functions can make this patient physically independent. So how do we manage? Arm pouch is given for 6 weeks. Elbow and hand movements are started intermittently, removing the pouch, okay, by properly supporting the shoulder. And you only achieve minimal shoulder function, but you have good hand functions. Now, when you come to the lower extremity also, the limb salvage is using different endoprostheses and using the grafts. So you have the bone grafting, you have the hip replacement surgery, knee replacement surgery, total femur replacement, pelvic reconstruction, and arthrodesis. Okay. So whenever there is some tumor of the lower end, you can see this is a graft that is used, and a plate or a nail is used to keep this graft in place. Normally it is plated and held in place. Now the graft can be either autograft, that is you use a tubular graft of the other knee, or you can use any iliac crest graft, there depending on how much the defect is. Or an allograft is used by using the from the bone bank. Whenever it is plated, healing takes place. Healing, you have to wait for at least 3 months. So till 3 months, the patient cannot really weight bear on the site. So there is osteosynthesis occurring. So once the osteosynthesis is seen, then only gradually weight bearing starts. Till that time, it is always non-weight bearing. a hinge knee, suppose if the graft is very close to the condyles, like condylar areas, it is at the lower end of the femur or say upper end of the tibia, then there is a lot of mediolateral instability also seen in these patients. So whenever you have to exercise these patients, the patients are always fitted in with a hinge knee brace. So your movements are not getting compromised. So therapy can be initiated immediately postoperatively. Range of motion exercises can be started for the knee immediately. But a hinge knee is given to prevent the mediolateral instability. And then weight bearing is initiated after osteosynthesis, after callus formation. Hip replacement, when you're treating, it is like any other hip replacement that you see, like a vascular necrosis or any hip osteoarthritis, that time you go for a hip replacement. Only varied thing is whenever a hip replacement is seen in tumor, in cancer, the process's length also increases because the resection length is more when you're dealing with cancer patients. That is why a TKR or a hip replacement for any other patient and for a cancer patient varies. Though the management does not vary much, but our rehabilitation takes longer time because of the length of the processes and lot of structures removed due to the disease. So hip replacement, you have to concentrate. That means an abduction splint or a pillow is given to this patient to maintain abduction so that there is no dislocation present. At the same time, a derotation boot is given to prevent external rotation, internal rotation of the limb. And you don't give any kind of no adduction or any rotations are advocated. Initially, for say a period of 2 weeks, the patient can go only 60 degrees. So it is not like any other hip replacement. We have to advocate only 60 degrees because the chances of dislocation is more. And you can start with all knee exercises. You can start with full weight bearing ambulation from day one, okay, with or without support. And you can do good quadriceps strengthening of the knee, ankle, everything is permitted, but using all the above mentioned precautions. So the patients are asked to walk with a little bit of abduction, or use some support, and they can go only up to 60 degrees of flexion. So you can see how the patient is coming out of bed, how the limb is supported by the therapist. And this is how the patient is turned. Two pillows are used between the legs. Okay, so patients are advised and asked to turn sideways this way. So it will be locked using two pillows to prevent any adduction. They are taught how to sit at the edge of the chair, maintaining the 60 degrees, and how to stand with the legs in abduction. So the chances of dislocation and because of muscle attachments are lost, these patients take longer time to get rehabilitated, but they still do full complete rehabilitation is achieved. Patients are functionally independent post hip replacement. Now coming to the total knee replacement, we have two types of processes or two types of total knee replacements. One which involves tumor of the lower end of femur and one which involves tumor of the upper end of the tibia. In either cases, though the management, there is a lot of difference between the management because of the structural removal. The processes can be an expandable processes, which is normally given in growing children, because in growing children, as their bones grow, the processes cannot be replaced on and off. So expandable processes are expensive, but they serve the purpose because you can, as the child grows, you can also increase the length of the processes. So there are certain magnetic fields, magnets present in the processes. So using a magnetic field, externally lengthening can be done. Or there are some magnetic screws which are there. So those screws, the processes are modular processes which move inward and outward. So using those magnetic screws and this, the slowly expansion is achieved as per the height growth of the child. But the standard thing, the processes that we normally, expandable is very minimally used, very expensive. Not everybody can afford it. So So for a lower end of femur total knee replacement, you can start with all the exercises immediately. You start with ROM exercises of the knee. You start with strengthening exercises, cemented processes. If they are, then you can start with immediate weight bearing. So full weight bearing exercises and walking is advocated from day one itself. Now coming to the upper end of TPM. There is a difference between the TKR in lower end of femur and upper end of TPM. Okay. Both are wide resection. One involves the femur, one involves the tibia. But when it involves the tibia, patella tendon, because the patella tubercle, where the tendon, patella tendon is attached, the tibial tubercle is lost. So what happens? Patella tendon has to be reattached. Now it is attached to the prosthesis. Now to hold this attachment in place, one head of the gastrocnemius is rotated around it and sutured. Augment this reconstruction of the patella tendon and to maintain it in place. And the patients are immobilized with a long knee brace for 6 weeks. So that means what? You are starting your knee range of motion exercises only after 6 weeks. That means you have an early mobilization here, but a late mobilization here. Also, another important factor as a physiotherapist you have to remember is whenever there is this reconstruction of patella tendon, then your quadriceps strengthening or your knee ROM should not be very aggressive. Because what happens is the moment you concentrate on your mobility exercises and you want to achieve a range of motion as soon as possible, what you are doing is by stretching the knee or by flexing the knee, you are stretching the patella tendon. The one that is attached, it is stretched. The moment a patella tendon gets stretched, that means its mechanical leverage is lost and you are having quadriceps lag for these patients. So that is one major thing you have to take care whenever you are mobilizing or treating this kind of a patient. So your strengthening of your quadriceps has to go hand in hand along with your ROM exercises. If you don't strengthen your quadriceps after 6 weeks and you only concentrate on mobility, you will get a quadriceps lag. So you can give CPM for these patients, general exercises, knee flexion, knee bending, all your SLRs and the standard protocol of quadriceps and hamstrings, mobility and strength can be seen. Now, this is what I meant by, like you can see. So whenever this is a patient whose tendon has got stretched. So what we have done is we have checked for the lower end of patella and the upper end of patella is marked. And you can see the distance in both the sides. On X-ray, if you see, you can see this. This is the patella. This is the tendon that is attached. So this will cause a lag to this patient. That means the patella is overridden and there is a patella tendon stretch present here. So this is a thing that we have to take care as physiotherapists and see that we do not cause this kind of a problem. Total femur replacement is nothing but a combination of your hip replacement and a knee replacement. So your treatment protocol remains the same. All the care for the hip replacement and the knee replacement is done. Only thing is because the length of the prosthesis is so long, the weight of the prosthesis is also involved. Patients may not develop good hip muscles and may always need some kind of aid while walking. Not necessarily a unilateral crutch, a simple walking what? Because the weight of the prosthesis is too much and they have to ambulate using that, taking that weight with little weak muscles present. Pelvic resections, another big challenge for the physiotherapist, because when it comes to cancer, it can involve any part. So when in the pelvic resection, you can see something called as a type 1, type 2, type 3, and the edge where the hip is also involved. Type 1 is nothing, only your ileum is removed. Okay. Type 2 is where your articular surface is lost. Okay, this is the ileum that is removed. This is the articular surface that is lost. type 3 is the issue. Now, when it comes to type 1 and type 3, there is not much problem, okay? Except that in type 1, your abductor origin insertion is lost. So what happens is the patient can have weak abductors and they walk normally, but sometimes you can see a Trendelenburg's gait that is seen. So you have to concentrate on the gait and the strengthening of the muscles. But ambulation and exercises can be started from day one. Major issue comes with this type of a surgery. Now, when you have this type of a surgery, it means your articular surface is lost. Okay, type 2. So what happens? Your weight bearing is getting compromised. Now, this femur that is there, it is either attached to this bone or it is attached to this bone, whichever. Okay. So wherever the attachment is, it can be attachment in the form of arthrodesis, or it can be using a plate, or it can be using some endoprosthesis, or it can be not done anything. That means it is just left like that only. The pseudo joint, they wait for a pseudo arthrosis to occur and a pseudo joint to form. At that time, the patient is in bed for 8 to 12 weeks, and after 12 weeks, only rehabilitation is started. So in bed, whatever rehabilitation is done, those are encouraged for the patient. So these are the different ways in which this type 2 internal hemipelvectomy are dealt with. So you can see this femur is attached by this small thing. So the fixation is not very stable. Okay. So you cannot directly go for the range of motion exercises here. So you wait for the stability, but you can start with non-weight bearing ambulation and the knee exercises and everything. Okay. When a prosthesis is involved, this is a pelvic prosthesis. Okay. You can start like any endoprosthesis treatment. That means you can start with the exercises immediately. You can start with ambulation. Okay. Ambulation with or without support. Full weight bearing, because most of the prostheses are cemented. So you can go for a full weight bearing prosthesis. Now, this is something where nothing is redone and it is just waiting for a pseudoarthrosis to form, okay? Or you can see these are some bone grafts and plates that are used. So there are different ways in which reconstruction is occurring. If arthrodesis is there, then you cannot have any hip movement, then you're using the spine movement. So for sitting up and everything, whatever spinal range of 30 to 40 degrees is available, you use that for sitting up. You can do good knee functions. You can do good ankle functions, and you can ambulate this patient using non-weight bearing ambulation using crutches. Okay. Now, when a pseudoarthrosis has to be formed, then the patients are not ambulated, but in bed, the patients are taught how to turn from one side to the other by using pillows in between. Their quadriceps muscles are strengthened by bringing the leg outside. Okay, so you can get good quadriceps strengthening, ankle strengthening, and you wait for the arthrosis to form before you start ambulation and walking for these patients, which is usually after 8 to 12 weeks. So each surgery is different. You can start with static quadriceps, knee mobilization, bedside, and ankle exercises. Change of position using pillows is advocated. Sitting up, as I told you, whenever there is arthrodesis or plating or anything, it is only the spinal range, which can be anything up to this much. Walking non-weight bearing with support after 6 to 8 weeks. And there is always a limb length discrepancy noted in age, because the femur tends to ride up. There is a pelvic tilt and there is a shortening which has to be compensated when the patients go for full weight bearing. Coming to amputations, as I told you, we finished with the salvage. Now, if you cannot salvage, then you have left with no choice but to amputate the limb. And you can have the standard below knee amputation, above knee amputation. The amputation management remains the same for any other management. That means you have to start with ambulation using crutches. You have to do the conditioning of the stump. Okay, a pylon can be fitted and made to walk. And there is a Borges home in Bandra, Borges home, which is a sister concern or a part of TMH, where there is a prosthetic orthotic department there. which is dealing with the preparation of these artificial limbs, okay? And these artificial limbs have got a different joint. They are called as a Tata limbs, which is provided to these patient cost-effective rates, and they facilitate functions for these patients. So good above knee processes are given with that patient, which can facilitate squatting and, you know, cross-leg sitting and everything. Another major amputation that we see is rotationplasty. Some of you may have heard of this, like, you know, it is a surgery exclusively that you see in cancer patients. So it can be in which what has happened, the limb is rotated 180 degrees. It is to have a functional knee joint. It is majorly done in adolescents, in children, everything. And they adapt very well to this surgery. Only thing is, psychologically, you have to prepare the patient for the surgery, because this appearance of the limb post-surgery is, that means it is looking rotated like this. Your foot is facing backwards, okay? So you are maintaining the neurovascular bundle. The tumor is resected up and below. The foot is rotated. Now your ankle comes up in the line of the knee, okay? And your ankle is serving as a knee joint, and the rest of the foot is plated together, okay? So since the foot is rotated, your dorsiflexors and plantar flexors are going to perform the function of the flexion and extension of the knee. That is why post-operatively, full ankle range of movement, this is how the foot looks post-operatively, elevation given immediately post-operatively for edema reduction. And the full range of motion and strengthening of the ankle is started, because the prosthesis, when fitted after the wound is healed and after the reduction of the deconditioned of the stump, okay, it takes at least about 3 months. So following the prosthetic fitting, if your ankle is not intact or if it does not have the full range and the strength, then this surgery is not of importance. Like, this surgery will not serve the same purpose as it is recommended for, okay? So strengthening and full range of ankle is important, because that is the crux of this surgery. This is how the weight bearing is started before the prosthetic training. So the limb is asked to sit on a stool or on the bed, and the patient is asked to weight bear before they initiate a prosthetic fitting. And these patients do well, children do well. They can run, they walk, they dance, some of them play also. Only thing is, the prosthesis has to be changed, because as they grow, you know, there is the size and the length of the prosthesis, so which requires change often. Good autowork prostheses are also there, endolite prosthesis. And there is this Tata prosthesis also, which is given, which is less, which is more economical and can be afforded by a lower economic group of patients also. Now, coming to the pain management. Pain management, as I told you, since cancer, the pain can be because of the disease itself. So we are not going to use any modality much. Infrared can be recommended, okay, for pain relief, but we don't have an infra. We are not using it anymore. So what we are concentrating is on the moist heat, cold pack, tens, and of course the manual techniques, massage, myofascial release. So electrotherapy has got very few grounds. Laser is another equipment which can be used for cancer patients, because laser is also used to treat. So it does not have much side effect, and low level lasers can be used for pain relief also in cancer patients. Now we will come to the side effects of chemotherapy and radiation. Okay. Now chemotherapy is given to practically most of the patients. It is coming either in the form of adjuvant therapy, that is given after surgery, or it is given as a neoadjuvant, sometimes to reduce the tumor size. It is given prior to surgery. So chemotherapy is given, reduction of the size of the tumor is achieved, followed by surgical removal of the tumor. Most of the chemotherapy are toxic drugs, okay, which needs to be washed off from the body. And as we say, they are systemic treatment, so it also affects the normal cells. And the cells normally are, which affects are the skin, your mucosa, and your hair. So that is why you have lot of GI symptoms, like you have nausea, vomiting, hair loss is a major effect, like, you know, post chemotherapy. Edema can be present. Peripheral neuropathy is one major thing that accompanies the patient when they are treated with chemotherapy. Drugs like vincristine and your paclitaxel, all the taxane-based drugs, they're very strong. They affect your nerves, and a lot of peripheral neuropathy can occur. Cardiotoxicity is also seen in some major group of drugs. So apparently, like, these patients who undergo chemotherapy, they have to be monitored on a regular basis. So their ECGs and echocardiograms and your 2D echoes are generally done to see that whether any cardiac toxicity is present. Peripheral neuropathy is normally patients are referred to the physiotherapy department whenever they have this problem. And we are physiotherapists have a role to play when they have to treat these patients. So you have to look at the motor affection, the sensory affection. So you can do desensitization exercises and certain modifications in their footwear and walking pattern, and everything has to be given. Okay, sometimes splints have to be given because they come up with a foot drop, you know. So then some kind of a foot drop splint and everything is given, or shoes to be made for these patients to facilitate ambulation and walking. So proprioception, stretching, passive exercises, strengthening exercises, and appropriate splints are used whenever you're dealing with these. TENS also helps in certain cases, you know, when there is some kind of a radiculopathy involved. One major thing that we have to look out is many times the patients land up with an extravasation injury. That means leaking of the drugs directly onto the skin. So since these drugs are basically very toxic, so they function just like an acid. So the wound that you can see is just like an acid burn, which may require some kind of a plastic surgery to cover the defect. So these patients, they come with a lot of contractures and they come with a lot of functional deficits. And we have to take care about all these things, and we have to give them good physiotherapy management, rehabilitation to get a good functional hand post this injury. Certain red flags and indications and precautions whenever we are dealing with chemotherapy. Chemotherapy reduces the blood counts. Whenever the patients are undergoing chemotherapy, you have to always watch out for their blood counts. What do you normally watch out for the blood counts? You watch out for the WBCs, you watch out for the platelets, and you watch out for the hemoglobin. If the WBCs are increased, then that means the patient is having some infection or is more susceptible for some infection. So during chemotherapy, you basically ask them to avoid going for any crowded spots. Always they're supposed to wear a mask to prevent any infection. Lot of fluid is, they're encouraged to have lot of fluid to wash away the effects of the, you know, the toxic drugs. Like, and cooked food is advised, not any raw food, because cooking kills the bacteria. So you watch for the platelet count whenever you have to exercise these patients. So if the platelet count is less than 50,000, then only active exercises are encouraged. You will not give any kind of a resistive exercise. So patients can do all ADLs and can do active exercises, can be recommended. If the counts are less than 20,000, exercise is recommended. So only ADL, whatever the patient is doing, you can ask the patient to continue that. You will not recommend even any active exercises, nor any kind of a resistive exercises. No exercises to be recommended, because there can be low platelets are there. So there can be bleeding problems present. And to avoid that, you don't advise any exercises. Even when you're giving chest physiotherapy in the ICU, for any chemotherapy patients who have landed up in the ICU because of pneumonia or anything, you watch out for the platelets. And if the platelets are less, you don't go for any vigorous, you know, clapping or percussion or nothing of that is advocated. Fatigue and tiredness is seen when the hemoglobin is low. So if hemoglobin less than 8, like, you know, you encourage them only active exercises in ADL. And if it is something less than 6, then you ask them to don't advise any kind of exercise. Radiation is treatment by using high energy X-rays and gamma rays, and it can be either be given as an external beam radiation, or it can be by putting needles inside and giving a brachytherapy. That means for small tumors, cavity tumors and small tumors, directly needles are put inside the brachytherapy needles, and using the, and these needles are targeted and the radiotherapy is given through these needles. So side effects is basically on the area and the dose of radiation. Okay. So whenever the radiation is given for a tissue, even the surrounding tissues are also involved. And that also causes a lot of damage to the surrounding structure. So which area is involved and how much of the area is exposed, the effects are depending on that. Brachytherapy always has less and lower side effects as compared to an external beam radiation. Because brachytherapy, the radiation is focused to one particular area, and the other surrounding normal tissues are not majorly involved. So for breast cancer, whenever radiation is given, you have these problems, like there can be a muscle fibrosis, which leads to impaired shoulder mobility. There can be some chest wall tenderness and pain, because what happens is the skin becomes very tensile, okay? It can break easily, and the radiation can cause a lot of burn there. So there can be a burning problem also. The burnt skin can get burnt. There can be radiation burn also. So all these can cause some amount of pain also to the patient. Unfortunately, you cannot treat this side, because a radiation, when it is given, the skin is very radiosensitive. So you cannot directly do any treatment on the skin. So no modalities can be used. You cannot use any myofascial release. You cannot use any massage, nor you can use any scar mobilization. So during the entire course of radiation, none of these things are done. Post radiation, before you have to confirm it with the radiotherapist, depending on the skin condition, before you can start with all your manual therapy procedures. Lymphedema can occur, as I told you, because radiation can cause fibrosis, impeding the lymphatic flow and causing stasis and lymphedema. There can be neuritis and plexopathy of the brachial plexus, as it lies very close to the site of radiation. When you are dealing with the head and neck cancer, you have problems like the swallowing difficulty, trismus, radiation trismus can occur. Okay, you can see this is a patient who is irradiated for head and neck. You can see the amount. Because she doesn't have teeth here, there is some opening. Otherwise, you can see that there is hardly any mouth opening. Okay. Shoulder and neck contractures and dysfunction can occur. So you have to concentrate on the release, that means stretching of these muscles, mobility, you have to concentrate on the mobility, and also you have to concentrate on the trismus by giving jaw stretchers. Bone and soft tissue, depending on what area. One is the bone, sometimes you have to, the weight bearing, you know, you have to prevent the weight bearing. So sometimes, like, you know, offloading has to be given to these patients, because when the radiation is given, the bones become brittle. There can be pathological fractures that can occur. So offloading is given to these patients. Either you give some splints to prevent, to maintain the position and prevent contractures, or you can ask them to use supports for offloading. So they can use a walker or a crutches or a cane to see that they don't weight bear on the radiated bones. Okay, and as I told you, tens can be given, but no heat and cold during the treatment, because the skin becomes radio sensitive. Cancer of the cervix, majorly it is treated by brachytherapy, and this brachytherapy causes a lot of vaginal stenosis. Okay, and incontinence is another major problem. There can be lower limb lymphedema. So there is a vaginal dilators that are present, which we use for these patients. So dilators come in different sizes. They are made of latex, okay? So the proper dilatation techniques are taught to these patients. They are asked to first use the smaller dilator and gradually progress to larger one to maintain the vaginal patency and to stretch and dilate the stenosed vagina. And even having sexual intercourse is also advocated and like recommended for these patients to maintain the vaginal patency. Also, incontinence is another major issue which can be treated with pelvic floor exercises or perineal exercises. Lymphedema management is similar to that of upper lymphedema management. The same manual lymphatic drainage, intermittent compression garment, and bandagings are done for the lower limb lymphedema also. When the thoracic area is involved in radiotherapy, you have these problems. You have cough, dyspnea, because radiation fibrosis occurs in the lung. So the lung gets fibrosed. So you can have the tightness of the chest wall, decreased pulmonary wheezing. Sometimes pneumonitis is present. And sometimes there can be some fistulas also which occur because of the radiation. So proper respiratory therapy, respiratory care is managed as per the requirement. Okay, whether to build up the reserve or for clearing of the lungs, it is advocated, and they are managed with good respiratory therapy. Cancer-related fatigue, another major issue, which I told you, as more than 60% of the patient cancer population faces it at one time or the other during their entire course of treatment. It is a distressing NCCN definition. It describes cancer-related fatigue as a distressing, persistent, subjective sense of physical, emotional, and or cognitive tiredness or exhaustion related to cancer or cancer treatment that is not proportional to recent activity and interferes with usual function. So there has to be a difference, you know, between the normal fatigue and the cancer-related fatigue. The major is cancer-related, the normal fatigue after taking rest is normally taken care of. But when you have a cancer-related fatigue, even after rest, your fatigue doesn't go away because it is basic physiological changes that is occurring in your body because of the chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and the disease itself, okay? So there is decreased nutrition, stress, sleep apnea, lack of sleep. All these things are also other causes. Some medical problems like, you know, decreased hemoglobin. It reduces the oxygenation. This also can leave a feeling of tiredness in your body. And the muscle weakness that is following because of this long-time CRF can be due to the pain, restricted range of motion, disuse, atrophy, neuropathy. So what basically you have to deal with is first identify fatigue. How do you identify it? You can use the brief fatigue inventory, or you can use the fatigue-associated chronic illness treatment tool that is present, you know. So these are questionnaires that are given to the patient. These questionnaires, BFI is a very easiest way to administer, because easiest way to give, it has got only four components, four questions. In last 1 week or last 24 hours, what the problem is like, you know. And if the BFI shows a score, it is a 0 to 10 score. So anything that is like, you know, more than 4, that means the patient has got fatigue. Anything less than 4 does not, it shows only mild fatigue and can easily be managed, okay, or no fatigue. If you have 4, more than 4, it can be moderate to severe depending on the index, whatever is there. Now, whenever fatigue is identified, you can see how much of fatigue by going through the next, the facet questionnaire. You have facet for different groups. Like, you know, you have the lung questionnaires based for the lung, for the cervix, for the esophagus, everything, the fat scores. So you can find out that, and that has got different components, which involves even the your ADL, as well as your quality of life, as well as your emotional and physical social problems along with your physical. Once you have identified, you have to see what are the factors that can modify. Like, for example, if it is a lower hemoglobin, that has to be corrected by the medical physicians. And if the nutrition, then the dietitian have to be involved to consider taking care of the nutrition. And we as physiotherapists have to concentrate on the energy conservation. So our fatigue diary is given to the patient. Patients are supposed to mark at what time of the day they are the most fatigued, what activity causes them more fatigue, okay? And so you see these, once you look at the fatigue diary, you understand, and you can give, when the patient is at the maximum energy level, you give all the higher energy expenditure chores to that patient during that period of time when the patient is having more energy. So you can give this kind of a conservation therapy. Certain distraction therapy, like, you know, hobbies, some group activities, and different kind of games and everything that can be taught to these patients for distraction. Some stress management can be done by meditation, relaxation therapy, yoga, etc. You can ask the patient to go for good breathing exercises to improve oxygenation, active exercises to maintain the strength of the muscles, and also walking as per the patient's capacity. So you assess the fatigue, you ask them to maintain a fatigue diary, and on the basis of that, you can incorporate all the following maneuvers to treat this patient. The standard, they say that for management of fatigue, like, you know, aerobic exercises and resistant training can be performed. Okay, so you do 3 days, you can give alternately aerobic exercises, you can give moderate intensity exercises have been advocated for these patients, which can be given at least, like, you know, thrice in a week, 3 to 4 times in a week, followed by strengthening exercises, which can be given using a resistance band or using the body weight for strengthening exercises. Now, after all these things, we come to something called as the palliative care. Palliative care is like when the patient has completed the treatment, when there is recurrence or disease present, and there is metastasis. And sometimes it is like that these patients are coming to the end of the care. So they say that there is an end to cure, but there is no end to care. That is what is the palliative care. WHO statement describes palliative care as an approach that improves the quality of life of patients and their families facing the problems associated with life-threatening illness through the prevention and relief of suffering by means of early identification and impeccable assessment and treatment of pain and other problems, physical, psychosocial, and spiritual. So the team of palliative care involves the doctors, the nurses who can take care, therapists who symptomatically address the problems for symptomatic relief of the problems, counselors, social workers for helping the patient for all other logistics like stay, accommodation, financial help, you know, all these other problems, and volunteers who can counsel and be beside the patient, bedside patient, to help them cope with their disease. So you can see these are the team workers who are caring for these palliative patients at their hospice or at their residence. The palliative can be given in hospice. So there is at Bandstand, you have the Shanti Avedana, which is basically for terminally ill patients. So there are doctors and nurses who are present there. Patient who cannot be tended or taken care at home can avail of this facility. One aide can stay with the patient, and all the terminal medical problems or requirements can be taken care at this facility. So what is our goal as physiotherapist? Our goal is basically to relieve the discomfort and to help the patient adapt to the physical limitations and permit optimal function. So our goal is not something very long-term goal. Okay, it is for that moment, what is the best that we can give for the patient, and we can improve the quality of life of this patient. Relief of discomfort, there can be breathlessness, metastasis is there, patient is having breathless. So what you can do, you can give them positioning. You can give them positioning to reduce their work of breathing. So accessory muscles they're using, so you can give them support, their shoulders can be relaxed, and, you know, they can forward bending can be adapted. So all these different positions can be given where you're reducing their work of breathing and relieving them of their discomfort. Okay, sometimes edema is there. Patients are not able to move their limb because of the edema. Then you can do the edema management for them. You can bandage or give them compression garment. You know, to whatever limitations and whatever maximize you can do of the optimal function, our role is to take care of that. So palliative care, as I told you, can be in the hospice or can be a home care. In TMH, the palliative care services was established in 1996. The home care services came into launch in 1998. And in 2002, the pediatric palliative care was added to the services of the unit. Cancer rehabilitation. Actually, it is too vast a topic. I may have missed out on something, like, you know, because to cover everything is impossible, next to impossible. But to summarize the cancer rehabilitation, it is basically prevention of impairments to functionally optimize. In spite of all the functional limitations, you try to optimize the function of the patient. You take care of the disability, you promote and maintain the health, you improvise the quality of life, and you restore the self-esteem and well-being. So thank you. It was a long talk.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm ready to take the questions. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a wonderful session. Can I put down the questions to you?
Yes, sure.
So we have the first question coming up. Saying, should we have to clamp the chest tube while giving percussion?
No, not recommended.
Okay. The next question says, what is the best treatment for MRM lymphedema apart from manual drainage, and how effective is MLD therapy? Please share your experience.
Okay. So there is a lot of evidence which says that, you know, manual lymphatic drainage by itself is not sufficient. Okay. So because you are only going to drain the fluid into the patent lymph nodes, but then the fluid can again build up and come back. Okay. So manual lymphatic drainage by itself is not sufficient unless and until you do a multi-layered bandaging or a compression. So you, whatever drainage you have done, it has to be maintained and seen that it does not come back. So you have to always complement it by using a multi-layered bandaging or a compression garment. So I, from my experience, that I recommend that manual lymphatic drainage is not having that much evidence. As such, the evidence is for bandaging. So if at all you have to treat a lymphedema patient, I would suggest that you go for a multi-layered bandaging, which not only reduces the edema, but it also improves the, reverts the tissue changes that has occurred. Like, you know, so if any fibrosis is present, even that gets broken down and the skin becomes, the arm becomes very soft. So my suggestions are, like, you know, only MLD is not as effective unless and until it is complemented by using a multi-layered bandage.
Okay. Okay. So the next question says, are full range exercises of shoulder started immediately post-operatively?
Yeah. So as I told you, like, you know, full range of motions is started post-operatively in major cases. Okay. Unless and until there is any reconstructive surgery that is involved. If any reconstructive surgery is involved, then the shoulder range of motion is delayed as per the plastic surgeon's instructions. Because normally the wound check after a reconstructive surgery is done on the fifth day. So once the wound is checked and if the plastic surgeon feels that now you can go for the full range of shoulder motion, then we immediately augment it, like, you know. So except for that, all other surgeries, we can start with range of motion exercises immediately unless it is specified otherwise by the surgeon.
Okay. So the next question says, when do you advise braces for a patient with multiple myeloma has a spinal metastasis? Is there any criteria for it?
See, whenever there is multiple myeloma, there is a lot of spinal lesions, like, you know, osteolytic lesions. Okay. So normally, if these lesions, they have, they can anytime, like, you know, during your spinal movements, like these lesions can, like, you know, cause a fracture. There can be a pathological fracture or they can cause some kind of a damage. So normally whenever multiple areas, levels of spine, there is lesions present. And if there is some amount of pain also along with this, then we always recommend a spinal support to these patients before we are going in for any kind of ambulation or mobilization. Because we don't know the extent of these lesions, like, you know, and how much damage they can cause. Like, so always to be on the safer side, we advise the patients to go for a spinal brace if you want them to go for any kind of physical activity.
Okay. The next question says, please throw light on management of side effects of ER, PR positive carcinoma when patient is on aromatase inhibitors.
Okay. Actually, see, per se, the management, physiotherapy management does not really change whenever it is an ER-PR positive. Okay. The ER-PR, basically, tumor markers are seen only to complement and give them an additional benefit of a chemotherapy, of a hormonal therapy. Okay. Normally, breast cancer treatment, like, you know, post-surgery, they always go in for an adjuvant chemotherapy. Now, a patient who is having an ER positive or a PR positive, that means they have got some kind of a hormone receptors present in which shows indicates that they have hormone receptors in them. So they have got the additional benefit of an hormone therapy. Okay. But from a physiotherapy point of view, our treatment doesn't at all change even if the patient is an ER positive or a PR positive. That is only for the hormonal therapy advocacy, and for that extra benefit of hormone therapy, these ER-PRs are taken into account.
Next question is, effectiveness of deep friction massage in keloid management.
Deep friction massage in keloid management. Okay. See, it is like, you know, basically whenever there is a surgical incision present, like, you know, keloid is like, we normally don't come across much keloid management. And as I told you, in our cases, like, you know, many times, like, we are not even allowed to do any manual therapy. Because most of the cancer patients, like, you know, following their surgery, after, like, you know, 3 weeks to 4 weeks, they have to go in for an adjuvant therapy. Now, if these patients are going in for a radiation therapy, then our, you know, scar mobilization or scar massage and all is automatically stopped, like suspended, because the, as I told you, the skin is very radio sensitive and we really cannot do any kind of a maneuvers there. But if radiation is not there, then you can go for these keloid management. What we have recommended is only deep friction massage, and we always ask them to use some kind of a lubricant or oil or gel, something which can soften these scars. Sometimes we even ask them to go for some moist heat therapy. So some moist heat therapy is given to basically soften these scar tissues, and then followed with any, I use any oil or gel to go for this deep friction massage. But believe, but remember one thing, if the patient is undergoing radiation, then you suspend all these treatment and you don't do it till the radiation is complete, until the radiotherapist can vouch for the skin condition and ask you to restart your scar mobilization.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. These are the questions ahead. We will now forward it to Dr. Gaurav. Ma'am, we need to put some slides.
1 minute. Before that, yes. Can I just take 2 minutes of everybody's time?
Sure, ma'am, sure.
Okay. And I would like to even, you know, how do I share another screen? I can share another screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, actually, I just want to put a slide, one slide about our Society of Onco-Physiotherapists. Like, since I, as already mentioned, we have registered the society in 2019, okay? And it is basically that, like, you know, we want members, like, you know, and we want to promote this society and we want to reach the masses. So I thought this is a platform from which I can reach to all the therapists and the practicing people that there is this society existing. So people who are working with cancer or who show an interest to work with cancer or who are already associated with some in some form or the other, that they can come forth and enroll themselves and join the society so that we can take onco rehabilitation to far more heights and levels, like, you know, which is our main aim. So that is the thing. thing, like I was feeling. So if just to take a contact of the email ID and the mobile number of the Society of Onco Physiotherapists, I just want to put up one slide. Like. Anyway, I'm sorry, I can't find it. That's okay. I'll convey it, like, you know, I'll put it in the, pass it to one of the person, and I think it can be circulated, like, you know.
Over to you, Dr. Gaurav.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Thank you for the wonderful session, ma'am. Before we go ahead, I would just like to speak about our sponsors. Just give me a minute, please. Okay, just give me a minute. Just give me a minute, please. Okay.
Meanwhile, all the participants, you will be getting a link in your chat box very soon, where you can just submit the feedback form and you all will get a e-certificate for the same. That will be mailed to you all.
Can you guys see my screen, please?
No, it's not visible.
Okay.
Also, ma'am, you can send the same details to Justy. So what we can we will be having the Excel sheet, so we can forward the details to each and every participant.
Yeah, yeah, sure. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Screen share. Can you guys access my screen now?
Yes.
Before we go ahead, I would just like to say a vote of thanks to our sponsors, Karani Toys and Sports Zone. Their shop is at near Parvati Cinema, close to the Vasai Railway Station. You guys can access it. And these are the numbers shared for your reference if you need to purchase some items from them. They deal in various products such as orthopedic soft goods, lymphedema kits, healthcare, mobility, wound care, fitness accessories, sports equipments, and sports apparels. You can see these are the lumbo, these are some of the products available with them. Lumbo lace pull brace, wrist splints, which are ambidextrous, functional knee supports as well. From our discussion, such lymphedema kit, which may include micropore tape, compressive wrap, short stretch bandage, TheraBand, soft compress, and therapy tape. They provide plenty of mobility aids at reasonable rates, such as offset canes, crutches, wheelchairs, walkers, and cot canes. Furthermore, they provide various exercise equipment such as resistance bands, mini exercise cycles, hand grip, gym ball, dumbbells, exercise cycles, and various exercise equipment. I would recommend all of you to copy their contact details for further reference. You can get in contact with them or you can reach one of us. We are happy to connect to you to them. Thank you. I'll just stop sharing the screen now and hand it over again. Thank you.
Ma'am, can you just on your video, please?
Is she there with us?
Is ma'am there or?
I can't see her with us, I guess.
Even I can't see her.
Can you just tell her to join for a few minutes?
Yeah, just a second. I'll call her up. her phone is not reachable.
Is she there or has she left?
It looks like she's not there. I'll try again, one second.
Rashmita? Yeah. Hello, Rashmita?
Bhavesh, I guess you can mute your...
I didn't get you.
Okay, anyways. Bhavesh, you can mute your mic.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you can mute your mic. I guess there's a disturbance from behind.
Because I'm not having mic right now.
Hello.
Hello,
ma'am. Radha ma'am, she just lost the connection. She's logging in again, she told me.
Okay, we'll wait for 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Ma'am. Dipali ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, actually, there was one Asha Menon's question. I guess we should take up that question. Rashmita, can you ask that question?
Yeah. Bhavesh, you can just off your mic. Yeah.
Yeah, Rashmita, can you just check?
Yes, yes. Okay, I will take it. I will take it.
Ma'am, there's just one more question from Asha Menon, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm so sorry, you know, because of connectivity, I just got logged off.
No, ma'am, absolutely fine.
Yeah. Okay, what is the question?
Yeah, the question says, post-op to breast surgeries, it is recommended that patient must not do repetitive arm movements, resisted exercises, push, pull, etc. in affected arm. Is it permanent or temporary? As long as patient is continuing the exercise to prevent lymphedema?
Yeah, actually it is a permanent thing, but it is not that they are not supposed to do it. It is repetitive movements. In a sense, like suppose if they are working up their arm, say for a half an hour, then they are supposed to give that arm some rest, okay? So immediately, say after half an hour, they are supposed to elevate, do some pumping exercises for the helping the drainage of the fluid, give some few minutes of rest to that arm before they pursue that task. That means all the tasks can be performed by these patients, but it is that they are supposed to perform it intermittently by giving intermittent rest to the arm. And if any activity is causing them any pain or it is causing them some discomfort, then they are supposed to stop that activity. That means that their arm is not...
Hello? Ma'am has lost the connectivity, I guess.
Yes.
She has some issues with her Wi-Fi. That is what she was saying. That is the reason she got locked out last time.
Okay.
I'll just message her to get again.
Yeah. Yeah, she's joining again.
Yes, the panel, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I guess all the questions are answered, and it was an immense pleasure to share the platform with you, ma'am. Your dedication absolutely reflected in the webinar I can imagine working with you would be so much of knowledge and so much of challenge to be. I mean, we are actually feeling that we are doing nothing. What you showed us.
Please.
Yes, yes,
thank
ma'am.
You so much.
It's from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you so much.
I, on behalf of IIP Central team, Maharashtra team, and Palghar district team, I really thank you. We had a renowned personality like you, and you shared absolutely maximum knowledge here. Also, I would take a chance to thank my Palghar team, because this was our first webinar and I could see that it was a real success. It all went very well. Also, I thank the central team and state team for having confidence in us and, you know, giving us the opportunity to take the webinar, which was a unique webinar. So thank you so much. Again, I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Bhavesh, Dr. Gaurav, Dr. Darshana, and Dr. Uttara ma'am for, you know, for the, all the trouble we gave you for the last 10 days for this webinar. So thank you so much. I tell the participants, I request the participants to now click the link in your feedback form in your chat box so that you receive your e-certificate. Once again, thank you so much, ma'am. Looking forward to meet you sometime.
Sure, nice. Same here. And I thank you all for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Should we keep the meet on for a few minutes so that we receive all the registration?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Rashmita and Gaurav can share the, you have already shared the
yes.
feedback.
Yes.